everyone, I'm Carol Anne Riddell, and welcome to Book It. We kick things off today with a riveting novel by one of our own. Author Elizabeth Nunez is a distinguished professor at Hunter College. Her new book, Now Lila Knows, is about a woman who arrives at a rural college for a visiting professor position, and then witnesses the fatal shooting of a black man by police. Elizabeth, thank you so much for sitting down with us today.
It is my pleasure. I love being on CUNY TV.
Thank you, and we love to have you. For people who might not be familiar with how the story unfolds, tell us the first couple of events in the book that set the stage.
Lila is coming for the first time to teach as a visiting professor at this college in Vermont, where there are only three black professors. And on her way to the college, on her way from the airport to the college, she witnesses this. This black man giving CPR to a white woman who is fatally shot by the police. When she gets to the college, she finds out that the black man who was shot was one of the professors. What she then encounters is silence.
Yeah.
Silence from the faculty, silence from the administration, and practically silence from the students, that life goes on. There's an acknowledgement, but there is no involvement. No one's doing anything. The two remaining black faculty do not say to her that she should be a witness. She should tell the police what she has seen. They do not put that pressure on her, but she is aware that they expect her to do it.
Correct, yeah.
And then she comes up one day, which is one of the pivotal points in the novel. She's going to have lunch in the cafeteria one day, and as she walks into the cafeteria, she sees a line of students. They have a banner which says Black Lives Matter, and they raise their fist in recognition of her. And when she gets into the cafeteria, she realizes that they didn't do that for the white faculty. They did it for her.
Yes.
So that there is a group of white students, young people, where I think the hope for our society is with these young people. They expect her. She sees that they expect her to join them in this protest.
But in the aftermath of the shooting, Lila struggles with what to do because she is, on the one hand, feels compelled to tell what she saw. On another level, almost seems to kind of question what she saw. And she's worried about the implications because she's an immigrant. What does it do to her status in the country, in the university, if she becomes a witness?
Yeah. Well, I guess I created a sort of foil for her. Lila comes from middle class, from the middle class society with those middle class Caribbean values. And her fiancé, who remains in the Caribbean, has those values. So she calls him, she tells him what she saw. Mm-hmm. And he is expressing in a way those values where he says to her, listen, stay out of this. You're not American. You don't understand America's
right.
racial problems. Just stay out of it. Don't get involved.
You don't have that responsibility.
Yeah. So that basically is the question that I ask all the way through this novel. Does everybody have a responsibility when they see injustice? Does everybody have a responsibility to act on it and not to remain silent? But then to up the ante a little bit and ask the question, does an immigrant have the responsibility? And of course, the immigrant says, this isn't my country, et cetera, or I can get in trouble, et cetera. And then I went even further to say, what about a black immigrant when this happens to an African-American? And the commonality being that they are both black.
One of the reviews of your book talks about how it provides an illuminating counterplay between Caribbean and American blackness.
Yeah.
What did you make of that, and what do you hope readers take away on that front?
Well, number one, I do not read my reviews.
Wise woman.
Yes.
But they sound very positive.
I haven't read any. Because I feel I can't write on if I, and if they're good, I'll feel so great, and if they're bad, I'll feel depressed. What's
okay.
the point? But yes, I think some people read the book that way. I have had people who are pretty high up in publishing who say to me, this is a book that should be read in high schools. I think it's important for Caribbean immigrants to understand that we benefit from the struggles of African Americans. On the other hand, it is important for African Americans to say there's something, there's a lot of some things that Caribbean immigrants can bring to African Americans.
It's also interesting in that that part of the book opens up this discussion around colorism.
Yeah.
And what that really means. How does it play out, though, within the novel?
Well, this comes again from Lila's fiancé, you know, who is talking about black, you know, you're not black. And she says to him, okay, maybe you want to say in the Caribbean we don't have racism in the way it spools out in America, but what we have in the Caribbean is colorism, mm-hmm. where you benefit from being lighter skinned.
There's a lot going on in the story because it is a story about an immigrant, and it is a story about Lila's kind of awakening, but it's also a romance.
It's a romance.
Right? So which also makes it very readable,
yes,
too.
I hope so, yes. It is a romance, and it's a romance in which I want to say has nothing to do with the color of your skin. And it has to do with the meeting of hearts and minds. So there is her fiancé from back home, Robert, who comes from the same culture, who comes from the same social class. Mm-hmm. And there is no meeting of the minds there.
Yes.
And there is Clive, who is American, who is white, who comes from a totally different background. And there is the meeting of the minds.
Elizabeth, you're a distinguished professor here at Hunter. I wondered, as I was preparing for this interview, how does being a professor inform you as an author? Does it change the way you go about writing?
Well, I consider myself a very lucky person. I have only wanted to do two things in my life, write and teach. That's all I wanted to do.
Well, then you hit the jackpot.
I certainly did. What I found out very early is I didn't want to teach high school. So once I knew I wanted to teach...
Not the easiest age.
The thing about it is that I never thought that I, as a black person from the Caribbean and a woman, could ever write something, a book, that people would read. It just didn't seem a possibility for me. Role models are essential, you know? So I say I came to writing vicariously.
So what gave you the bravery, the clarity, the moment to begin writing intentionally as opposed to sort of vicariously?
A mentor.
Isn't that how it always goes?
A mentor. At this point, I'm the chairperson of my department. And John Oliver Killens, an African-American writer, comes to my college as a writer-in-residence, and I secretly tell him my secret ambition.
Yeah.
And he says, let me see what you have, and I show him, and that's it. I took the year off, and I never turned back.
I love to hear about the process of writing for authors. Do you have any particular habits or quirks, or is there anything you have to do in order to sort of start the creative working?
I surround myself with books. And books that I love. Mm. And part of the reason is it gives me courage, because writing a novel is climbing Mount Everest.
Yes, I imagine, right? It would be.
And so it's such a daunting task. And sometimes to get myself going, I would start reading a passage of a favorite book of mine. Huh. And it's kind of like fuel that, you know, somebody did this. Books that I like, writers that I admire, I would usually start my writing day by reading them.
Well, I admire it. I don't think I could do it myself, but...
Well, they've done it, so you can do it.
Well, you know. So you say.
So I say.
Thank you so much for all this time. I really enjoyed chatting with you, and I really enjoyed the book.
Thank you so much. It was my pleasure and my honor.
Now to a fascinating biography that explores the life of Elsie Robinson. She was a Maverick, born in 1883, and became a wildly successful columnist. So why haven't we heard more about her? Now we will. We sat down with Allison Gilbert to talk about her book, Listen World. So Allison, it has been a minute.
This is so fun. I haven't seen you in so long in person. It's
so
nice.
I know, exactly. So we worked together early on in our careers. We've known each other for years back at New York One News. And now your book is bringing us back together.
And it's about a journalist. So it's the perfect full circle opportunity.
It really is. So let's start there with your book. Yes. It's called Listen World, and it is the biography of Elsie Robinson. So tell us a little bit about Elsie Robinson.
Elsie Robinson was born in the late 1800s at a time where women were really feeling suffocated, or many women, I should say, were feeling suffocated by what they were allowed to do, by the social pressures of the day to have children, to of course be married prior to having children, to stay in the home. And she just wanted, she craved this richer, bigger life. And that's what her story, her journey represents to me, is someone who went for it.
And as a journalist, she reached quite, at least at the height of her career, quite a large audience.
She reached more than 20 million readers. And to put that into context, that's double the number of current subscribers to the New York Times. Mm-hmm. Her reach was enormous, and people sat up, they paid attention, because she had a seminal voice.
And yet, Allison, you say, you point out in the book, that a lot of people have no idea who she was.
I had no idea who she was.
Why is that?
Gosh, there are so many reasons, and I think there's been a steady erasure of women's histories in this country. We don't sit up and pay attention to women. The National Women's History Museum has done the research on this, and they have found that only 24% of all historical figures in U.S. public schools being taught are women. And so if you're not being taught about these women, how do you learn about these women?
And why do you think she was not silenced by the more common thinking of that time?
Oh, that's easy, because people read her column. And so the power of her day was who was buying the paper. And if you got people to buy the paper, then you were good. And she went for it. She asked for raises. All of her bosses, by the way, were men, including William Randolph Hearst. And she was not afraid to ask for what she was worth.
So let's dig into Elsie's life a little bit more. She was born in California to a poor family, but ended up marrying, ultimately, unhappily, into a wealthy Vermont family.
Very wealthy, yes.
And what were those early years of her life like? Because she was not the pioneer at that time, you know, at least publicly.
Yes, no, she was going into that mold of what was expected of women at the time. She was going to get married young. She was going to have children young. She ended up having one son young. She was playing the role of the proper New England wife. She was trying on that outfit. She was trying to make it work, and she hated it. She felt suffocated. And it's not surprising that years into her marriage, she was just, she wanted this bigger life. She started writing on the side. She started illustrating on the side, and it kept feeding her.
So she goes back to California with her son. She's ultimately divorced, which is also unusual at that time.
Very.
She's in dire financial straits at that point. And she ends up working in a mine. The only woman.
Yeah, this is insane. So she goes to a gold mine where she is the only woman laborer in a sea of men, working 600 feet below the surface of the earth looking for gold. She had moxie, Carol Anne. I can't describe it in any other way.
The biggest heartbreak of her life had to be when her son George died.
Oh, yes.
And can you tell us a little bit about the circumstances of George dying, of her son dying?
It was actually really sad. So he suffered chronic asthma throughout his whole life. There was the flu epidemic in 1926, and one thing fell into the other and complicated his asthma, and he couldn't recover from the flu. And so it was complicated by his asthma, but he died of the complications of both diseases together. I think on the artistic front, she used his loss to fuel her writing. She wrote a lot about grief and loss in a way that really spoke to me personally. I lost my mom, and so to me, reading about her words about loss and grief and moving forward were incredibly impactful. In fact, during World War II, when women were shipping off their sons to war and losing them, or fearing the unknown of what was happening to their child. She wrote about that from a place of utter compassion.
So we've talked about, and you talk in the book about how many people don't know who Elsie Robinson was. I understand you discovered her in 1996 yourself, but you didn't know who she was prior to that, is that right?
I had no idea who she was. So the story behind my discovery is also, we talked about Elsie writing very personal things. My mother had just died, and I went back to my childhood home in the Bronx, and I was cleaning out my mother's belongings, and inside, well, I brought it with me. I could show it to you.
Yes, I'd love to see it.
So inside one of my mother's books falls out this piece of paper. It falls out of one of her books. And it's a piece of onion skin paper, and it had a poem on it. Mm-hmm. And can you see there?
Yeah.
It has Elsie Robinson's name on it. And I had no idea who she was at the time, but the poem was like this well-meaning slap in the face, like a tough love poem about pain. And I'm like, who is this Elsie Robinson? So that set me out on this journey to discover who Elsie Robinson was.
So I have to ask you, Allison, what is the poem about and what did it mean to you in that moment?
Well, it's tough. It was a poem about grief and it's called Pain. And it's a real tough love poem about pain. And at that moment, you mentioned 1996, I was 25 when my mom died. It felt really young. It is really young. And I was unraveling, to be quite honest, about her death. And this poem pretty much said, be lucky you had a mother worth missing. It's like a well-meaning slap in the face.
But really, what you needed in that moment?
It is what I needed in that moment.
So that was in 1996.
Yes.
Has Elsie Robinson just been kind of running around your brain ever since?
I have to say she has. I couldn't let her go. I started researching her slowly, putting it aside, digging a little more, putting it aside, writing other books, putting it aside. And then I had to focus on it. 11 years ago, I made a decision that this was the next book I had to really focus on and make sure I could come to fruition. And I was lucky to partner with Julia Shears, my co-author, and together we were able to take it over the finish line.
Do you think that Elsie's place in history will change with this book?
I don't know. I only have the hope. And I know it's the first biography that's been written, so that can be of use.
Just a last question for you, Allison. What would you say you learned from Elsie?
That is a really good question. And I pause because of how I found out about her was after my mom died. And I think a lot of Elsie's voice parented me in some ways when my mother couldn't. And she was all about going for what you want and being brave in the face of all sorts of adversity. And that appeals to me. And it made writing about her and learning about her and being with her words really a rich experience.
Thank you so much for all the time.
Oh, this was such a joy. Thank you so much.
I love the book, and boy, it is great to see you again.
It is just so nice to see you in the flesh.
Yes. Now to our regular segment, Uncensored, with award-winning columnist and author Linda Stasi. As always, she's got plenty to say about what she's reading.
It is almost impossible to describe just how horrible Jared Kushner's so-called book, Breaking History, actually is. It's been described by other reviewers as soulless, and that if it came down to reading it or having a rusty crowbar inserted into a body orifice, a crowbar is the way to go. Problem is, you can never find a crowbar when you need one. Kushner begins by excusing away his own father's conviction for illegal campaign contributions, tax evasion, and witness tampering as nothing more than a setup. No wonder he married a Trump. Breaking History was clearly written for two reasons. The first was to shamelessly laud himself for everything he's done from grade school on. And the second was to throw more people under buses than there are vehicles in the entire MTA fleet. A fetus elitist, Jared, is so clueless that he writes how he and Donald Trump understand the average working stiff. Then he throws celebrity names around faster than his father-in-law threw paper towels in Puerto Rico. For example, he says how he and Ivanka reconciled after a breakup over religious differences. Where? On Rupert Murdoch's yacht in the Mediterranean. So average Joe, right? Then he says the couple went to Bono's house with Billy Joel where Bob Geldof sang for them. But to land this skinny suit son of a con, Ivanka first had to agree to convert to Judaism. Who wouldn't do anything for a guy this special? As for his White House years, suffice to say that if Jared hadn't been there, the country would have crumbled. Well, some think it did, but that's another story. Jared's proudest accomplishment, he writes, was the Abraham Accords, in which he almost single-handedly solved thousands of years of conflict in the Middle East. Too bad the Israeli press recently deemed it a failed tourist scheme. See, millions of Israelis have flocked to places like Dubai, while this year only 3,600 tourists from the Accord countries went to Israel. You know what? Maybe Jared should have offered Abraham Accords miles. Bottom line, breaking history is so full of hot air, I think it should have been called breaking wind. Now, from the ridiculous to the sublime. You know what I love about fiction? It's how skilled authors come up with plot ideas so obscure, you should never care about them until you can't get enough of them. Take Chris Brazilian's new novel, The Lioness. It's about a 1960s movie star who takes her new Gallerioni hubby and her closest loved ones on a luxury African safari. Really? Who cares? I did, and you will too, because Brazilian so deftly weaves in the backstories of seemingly shallow celebrity characters. You not only care about them, you pull for them not to be killed off. No, not by the lions and wild beasts, but by the Russian mercenaries who kidnap them for ransom. Then it's the wild beast turn. The Lioness is hair-raising, it's scary, and a perfect read, especially if you're safely at home on your own couch. Talk about when bad things happen to good people. I'm Linda Stacy, and I'm still uncensored.
So, The Lioness, wow. I loved it too.
Loved it. It's so good. The guy is such a good author.
It was interesting to me, the fact that it was set in the 1960s made it scarier for me because there was this sense of peril around, you know, there's no social media, there's no cell phone. And the characters, as you said, you really get invested in them.
You know, I really, when I first started reading the book, I thought, what do I care about these shallow movie stars? And everybody seemed like they were going to be so shallow.
Right.
One's a movie star, one's, you know, a
would-be. They're all fabulous.
A would-be gallery owner who never made it.
Yes.
And the other one is the PR guy who makes up stories about the movie stars so that they get good press. And I thought, but you get so invested in them because Bajalian does this great backstory on everybody.
And alternating perspectives. And the ending, we won't give it away, but wow, so good.
So good.
So good.
Shocking.
So good. Okay, we gotta talk now. Breaking history.
Or breaking wind.
Well, your review was like a lot of reviews. People were pretty tough on that book, pretty snarky actually. So I'm gonna say something though, and Linda, do not throw your coffee at me.
Uh-oh.
Do not throw your coffee at me. Do you think these like post-White House memoirs have some value, no matter what side of the political aisle you're on, and even if they're not well-written? Because there's some interesting insights. There was moments that I was interested in. Look at the way she's looking at me.
What? When he solved the Middle East crisis? When he was on Rupert Murdoch's boat and Bob Geldof? Please!
Okay,
what
I know.
What insights?
Okay, so
what, that
I'm
his
not
father
saying,
should his I'm father saying, shouldn't have gone to jail for witness tampering.
I actually thought that opening story was kind of interesting because it got really into the salacious details. Also, I liked reading about the conversations around COVID from the vantage point that we are in now. I'm not saying it was a great book by any stretch. By any stretch, I agree with the reviews in terms of the writing, but I do think that these memoirs have sort of a value for us generally.
What about the fact that everyone who's ever been in Jared Kushner's life speaks with the wisdom of Solomon, all platitudes. His grandmother only said brilliant things. Yes. Everybody always says, like, brilliant. Why couldn't he, if they're all so brilliant, why couldn't he come up with one line?
I did think that the book lacked some self-awareness, but I have one last thing to say about it.
No!
I liked looking at the pictures.
Would you spend that much money to look at pictures? Go online, look at pictures. You don't need to give this guy, and I am so resentful to you and everyone else that I spent money, actual money that I earned to read this.
Okay. Well, how do you really feel? That is our show for today. Thanks so much for watching. A quick reminder to check us out on Facebook and Instagram. We'd love to hear from you, especially if you disagree with Linda. We'll both be back next time. See you then on Book It.